Hello and welcome to my channel. In this series of videos, you will learn about application of slope deflection method for analysis of indeterminate structures. Slope deflection method is used to calculate bending moments at supports and joints of continuous beam and portal frame without sway and with sway. In this first video, we will understand how to write the slope deflection equations for members of indeterminate structure and what are the sign conventions used in writing slope deflection equations. So first of all, we will understand what are the different factors which contribute to final end moments of any member. So let us start. To understand what are the different factors that contribute to final end moments, we will consider this example of continuous beam. Let us consider a part of continuous beam. Now let me tell you that whenever we solve any problem using any of the method, that is slope deflection method, moment distribution method, or Carney's method, or any other method, we always calculate or we always get the value of bending moment at the supports or at the joint. We do not get the bending moment along the length of the member. We always get end moment of that member. If the member is AB, we get the final end moment MAB and MBA. So consider the part of this beam, continuous beam. Suppose it is subjected to certain load. There is rotation of joint A, there is rotation of joint B, and there is some sinking of support. So this is a general case of a part of a continuous beam. Now first we will see what is the effect of theta A on final end moment. So if there is a rotation of any end, suppose this is theta A, then we know that stiffness of beam. What is stiffness? Stiffness, flexural stiffness means the moment required for unit rotation. When this slope is equal to 1, what is the moment required to make this slope equal to 1? And we know that that stiffness is 4 EI by L. So if 4 EI by L is the stiffness, then to rotate this end by theta A, we require moment here 4 EI by L theta A. So this is the moment required to rotate this by theta A. So because of the rotation, this moment is developed. Now we know that if the moment is developed at one end, it is carried over to other end if other end is fixed. We are not applying any moment here. Moment is developed here, but this moment is carried over to other end to maintain this slope equal to 0. So if this is 4 EI by L theta A, then the moment developed at other end is 50% of it, which is equal to 2 EI by L theta A. So this is the effect of rotation of joint A. So because of rotation of joint A, these two moments are developed. 4 EI by L theta A at near end and 2 EI by L theta A at far end. Then next we will see what is the effect of theta B. So we are considering positive direction of rotation, that is clockwise rotation. So because of this, again here also, what is the moment developed? So for theta B, it is 4 EI by L theta B. Because for unit rotation, we required moment equal to 4 EI by L. So for theta B, it is 4 EI by L theta B. So if the moment developed here 4 EI by L theta B, then 50% of it will be transferred to other end. We are not applying any moment here, but it is because of this, the 50% of this is transferred here to maintain slope 0 here. So if this moment is 4 EI by L theta B, this will be 2 EI by L theta B. So this is the effect of rotation of joint B. Next we will see what is the effect of this sinking of support. We know that because of sinking of support, moment develops are 6 EI delta upon L square. And its nature is like this. If the right support sinks, then to maintain slope here zero, the moment required is like this, anticlockwise direction. Similarly, to maintain slope zero here, moment required is in anticlockwise direction. And the magnitude of this moment due to sinking of support is 6 EI delta upon L square. So, because of sinking of support, these are the moments. Now, there is external load also. So, if there is external load, we know that fixed end moments are developed. So, whenever we analyze the beam or any portal frame, initially we consider all the members are fixed beams and we calculate fixed end moment due to the load. So, these are the fixed end moment due to the load. Now, all these contribute to the final moment at A. So, what is final moment at A, MAB? It is addition of all these four factors, which is 4 EI by L theta A plus 2 EI by L theta B minus 6 EI delta upon L square. And then to this, we add the fixed end moment. So this is the, these are the factors which contribute to the final moment at A. Similarly, if you calculate final moment at B, then it is 2 EI by L theta A plus 4 EI by L theta B. Here we are considering right support is sinking. So we are considering minus 6 EI delta upon L square. And then to this, we have to add the fixed end moment. It may be positive or negative. So this is how we calculate final moment at B. So in short, in final moment, there are four factors. One is contribution from the rotation at near end. Second is contribution from the far end rotation. Third is sinking of support. And fourth is the moment developed, fixed end moment developed due to the load. So finally, when we add this, we get slope deflection equation. Now let us see how the slope deflection equation look like. So as I told you that there are four factors which contribute to the final moment at any support, which is rotation at near end, rotation at far end, sinking of support, and fixed end moment due to the load. So what is the final moment at end A? MAB. When we say MAB, it means bending moment at support A whose far end is B. That is the notation. Bending moment at support A whose far end is B. So as I told you that there are four factors. So we add all these four factors. If you take 2 EI by L common from this, then this equation can be written like this. 2 EI by L twice theta A plus theta B minus 3 delta upon L plus fixed end moment, MFAB. MFAB means, M means moment, F means fixed end moment at A whose far end is B. So this is how we develop the slope deflection equation. So remember that if you are calculating bending moment at A, then these two factors you have to write with theta A. If you are calculating bending moment at B, then you have to write two factor with theta B. Let us see how it is. So final moment at end B. So as I told you that final moment at end B, just now we have seen this is addition of all these four factors. So if you add these four factors, we get the equation 4 EI by L theta B plus 2 EI by L theta A minus 6 EI delta upon L square plus MFBA. So what is MBA means? It is bending moment at support B whose far end is A. So if you take 2 EI by L common, we get 2 EI by L twice theta B plus theta A minus 3 delta by L plus MFBA. Now remember that we are calculating moment at B. So we are writing 2 with theta B and 1 with theta A. Whereas when we write moment at A, we write 2 with theta A and 1 with theta B. This is how we can remember these equations. So these MAB equations and MBA equation, these equations are called as general equations of slope deflection. Okay, these are the slope deflection methods equations. So using these equations only, we are going to solve any problem of continuous beam or portal frame. Now we will see if the member is without sinking of support. In earlier problem, we have considered this delta. Okay, while deriving the equation, we have considered the delta, but sometimes if there is no delta, if there is no sinking of support, then these equations are modified like this. We can neglect this 3 delta by L term from the equation. And finally, we get equations MAB is equal to 2EI by L twice theta A plus theta B plus fixed end moment. Okay, so this is how we write the equation. We are calculating at A, so writing here theta A twice. Calculating at B, writing theta B twice. So these are the general equations of bending moment, how to calculate bending moment using slope deflection equations. So when we write the general equation of slope deflection, we write like this. MAB is equal to 2EI by L twice theta A plus theta B minus plus 3 delta upon L plus MFAB. Now what is this minus plus? Minus is when right support sinks. Because here, if right support sinks, to maintain this slope zero, we require anti-clockwise moments. So here anti-clockwise moments are developed and therefore we consider minus sign if right support sinks. If left support sinks, then to maintain this slope zero, we require clockwise moment. The moment developed due to sinking are clockwise and therefore we have to consider plus sign. So if sinking of support is, if right support sinks, use minus sign. If left support sinks, use plus sign. Then you have to remember that for each member, you have to write 2 equations. So total number of slope deflection equations are equal to number of members multiplied by 2. If there are n number of members in the structure, then total slope deflection equations will be 2 times the n. N is number of members. So finally, the slope deflection equations look like this. These are the general equations of slope deflection. We have to remember these equations. And I told you what is the meaning of minus and what is meaning of plus. Now, just now we have derived the equation of slope deflection. Now, let us see what are the assumptions made in deriving these equations. So, first assumption is we consider all the joints as rigid. Rigid joint means if the angle between two members at the joint is say 90 degree before deformation, then because of the loading, suppose this joint rotates, it rotates as a whole, means whatever angle is there before deformation, same will be there if you draw the tangent to the curve, the same angle is maintained. So it means the angle between any two members meeting at joint does not change even after deformation due to loading. That is, the joint rotates as a whole as shown in this figure. So if the angle is 90 degree, it will remain 90 degree after deformation. That is the meaning of all the joints are considered as rigid. Now what is second assumption used? In this case, the distortions due to axial and shear stresses are neglected since they are very, very small as compared to the distortion due to flexure. So here we do not consider axial deformations in the member and therefore while calculating degree of kinematic indeterminacy, in this case, we neglect the axial deformation. That is one of the assumptions. So these are the two important assumptions in slope deflection method. In this slope deflection equation, these rotations are called as primary unknowns, because unless we calculate these thetas, we cannot calculate final moment. So what is slope deflection method? We learn many methods for in structural analysis. Whatever method we study, like slope deflection method, moment distribution method, Kani's method, stiffness matrix method, etc., all these methods can be grouped in two categories. These two categories are force method and displacement method. So this slope deflection method is a displacement method, because here primary unknowns are displacements. So slope deflection method is a displacement method of analysis in which primary unknowns are displacement, that is rotation at the joints. Then this method is used to analyze the indeterminate beams and portal frames. In this method, in order to analyze the structure, it is required to determine the displacement first. So as I told you that primary unknowns are theta. So first of all, we have to calculate those thetas. And how we can calculate those thetas? Those thetas can be calculated by applying joint equilibrium conditions. So in displacement method, we always use joint equilibrium equations. So using joint equilibrium equations, first we calculate the displacements. This method was first presented by Professor George A. Manney of University of Mentos in 1915. So in short, what is this slope deflection method? So in this method, equations are written for moments at end of the member in terms of slopes, that is rotations and deflection of joints. And then we calculate those unknown rotations using equilibrium equations. Once we get those rotations, then we can substitute those rotations, those values in the equations again, and then we can calculate the final end moment using again the slope deflection equations. So for every equilibrium equation, we get one equation, and therefore this method involves solution of simultaneous equations. Hence, if the structure has more than three unknown displacements, then it becomes difficult to analyze the structure manually. So if in any structure degree of kinematic indeterminacy is more, then in that case this method is not convenient. In such case, you can use moment distribution method or Kani's method. So when degree of kinematic indeterminacy is less, then this slope deflection method can be used comfortably. But we are studying this method because this method is based for stiffness matrix method. Actually, stiffness matrix method is a matrix form of slope deflection method only. And therefore, it is important, it is required to study this slope deflection method. And why we use stiffness matrix method? Because stiffness matrix method is commonly used for analysis of large structure using computer programs. So we can develop a computer program for stiffness matrix method. And to study this stiffness matrix method, slope deflection method is the base. And therefore, it is important to study this slope deflection method. And therefore, we are studying this slope deflection method. Now we will understand the step-by-step procedure to analyze any indeterminate structure using slope deflection method. So whatever structure is given, it may be a continuous beam or a portal frame. Then first step is always determine unknown displacements in the structure, excluding axial deformation. So unknown displacements are always the rotation at the joints, that we will see while solving the problem. how to decide the unknown displacements. Then second step is, whatever members are there in the portal frame or in a continuous beam, first of all, consider each span as fixed beam and calculate fixed end moment at the end of each member. And then for each member, write two slope deflection equations. You know that for each member, at each end, we have to write one equation. So per member, there will be two slope deflection equations. So suppose in a structure, there are n number of members, then total slope deflection equations will be 2 times n. So after writing slope deflection equation, we have to calculate the unknown displacements. So for calculating unknown displacements, we have to apply the equilibrium conditions. So let us see how to apply the equilibrium condition. Suppose this is a part of beam. So rotation at the joints are the unknowns. So theta b and theta c are the unknowns. So therefore we have to apply equilibrium condition at that point. So suppose you apply the equilibrium condition at joint B. So applying at joint B, how we can write MBA plus MBC is equal to 0. So this is called as equilibrium condition. Summation of moment at B equal to 0. That is MBA plus MBC equal to 0. Similarly, if theta C is unknown, we can write here MCB plus MCD is equal to 0. So what is MBA means? MBA is nothing but the equation of MBA in terms of theta A, theta B, etc. MBC is also an equation which consists of theta B, theta C, fixed end moment, etc. So if you add these equations, you will get the equations of equilibrium. So the number of equilibrium conditions will be equal to number of unknown displacement in the structure. So after calculating displacements, after solving those equations, we get unknown rotations. So when we apply equilibrium conditions, we will get simultaneous equations. So after solving this, we will get unknown rotations. So if answer is positive, then rotation is clockwise. And if answer is negative, then rotation is anticlockwise. This is our sign convention. So we substitute these answers in the equations which we have already formed for slope deflection for each member. So if you resubstitute these values of thetas, we can calculate final moments at end of each member. And once you get final moment, we can draw the bending moment diagram. And suppose you want to draw the shear force diagram, then to draw shear force diagram, first calculate reactions at the support using free body diagram, and then calculate shear force at various locations, and then you can draw the shear force diagram. Now, first of all, we will see what are the sign conventions we are using while solving the problem. So, as I told you that whatever structure is given to you, first of all, you have to consider all the members are fixed beam and you have to calculate fixed end moment. So, whenever we will calculate fixed end moment, we will consider this sign convention, clockwise positive and anticlockwise negative. So, this is the sign convention to calculate fixed end moments. Next is joint moment. Sometimes there is overhanging part in the structure. So if there is an overhanging part in the structure, in that case, the moment, this is a determinate part. We do not require any method to solve this part because this is a determinate part. So what is moment here? P into force into perpendicular distance, so P into A. So if there is an overhanging part, then while calculating the moment, we have to consider clockwise negative and anticlockwise positive. So you can see here, this moment is clockwise, this you have to consider negative, and this is anticlockwise, which you have to consider positive. So this is the sign convention for joint movement. Next sign convention is for slope. Slope means rotation. So if tangent rotates clockwise, this is the tangent drawn to this deflected curve. If this tangent rotate clockwise, initially before loading it was straight, after loading it is rotated clockwise. So if the rotation is clockwise, you have to consider positive. If rotation is anti-clockwise, you have to consider negative. Then sinking of support or settlement of support. As I told you that if right support sinks, then anti-clockwise moments are developed. And at both the end, the magnitude is 6 EI delta upon L square, and it is negative. If left support sinks, then it is positive 6 EI delta upon L square. So this is sign convention for settlement of supports. So whenever we analyze any structure, so there are fixed end moments due to external loads. So we always first calculate the fixed end moments. So now we will see some of the standard formula used to calculate the fixed end moment. You have to remember this formula for different type of loads. If there is a point load acting at center of the span, then remember that at left support, if the load is downward, left support is minus and right support fixed end moment is plus. So it is minus WL by 8 and plus WL by 8. If the load is eccentric, then it is minus WAB square by L square plus WA square B upon L square. Then if there is UDL, this is the formula, WL square by 12. If there is triangular load like this, or if there is triangular load like this, so these are the formula you have to remember to calculate the fixed end moments. You can also remember the formula for some special type of loads like partial UDL or moment acting. So in case of moment, you can remember that if the moment is clockwise, the fixed end moment develops are also in the same nature. So if it is clockwise, the moment developed at the end will also be clockwise. And you have to remember all these formula for solving any problem. So this is how we calculate the fixed end moment. So in this video, we have derived the slope deflection equations, which we are going to use while solving the numerical examples. Then we have seen the steps for analysis of indeterminate structure by slope deflection method. We have also studied the sign conventions used in analysis of structure and how to calculate the fixed end moments for different types of loads. We have seen the formula to calculate the fixed end moment for different types of loads. So in next video, we will solve some numerical example. So stay connected. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you very much.